pretend that.
Okay. If you recall, we were going to come back to identify implementation requirements for management options, as well as the further scoping of the geographic areas, excuse me, and then have a conversation on agreeing on the format and content of the your management strategy. So just to start the conversation on the implementation requirements. Page 3 of the terms of reference also indicates under the heading management options, the second paragraph below that heading, that a number of short and long-term strategies are required to address current, immediate conflict issues and long-term population levels. Each of these strategies requires intergovernmental cooperation to achieve results. So just paraphrase that, taking that right out of the terms of reference. So what we're getting at, over the course of looking at all the evaluation criteria and having the discussion on each of the management options, you know, we've got references to the province having a role, and then the recommendations are going to the region. In the terms of reference, it indicates that implementation might have to be in partnership or best is in partnership with municipalities. And then are there others? From time to time, we hear about the use management strategy and, for example, the way the Victoria International Airport got involved because the problem, some problems encroached onto their property. So they would be kind of like a stakeholder. Are there any stakeholders that we can identify in this program? And, you know, what are the rules appropriate to these jurisdictions? So, in terms of the geographic areas, the way that's worded is scoping areas where measures are most warranted. So I had phrased it as distribution of the issues. So clearly, even though we've identified these three kind of macro geographies of agricultural, rural and urban, there's still, you know, kind of generic geographies that could be anywhere in the region. But the problem isn't, or problems aren't necessarily distributed evenly across the regions or even across those jurisdictions. So which jurisdiction, or what is the best sort of decision-making body when it comes to considering the recommendations for a deer management strategy? And if I left any out here, that would be my last conversation too. And then there's also the question of who has the authority to actually implement any of these besides to do nothing. And, you know, as we discussed along the way, different levels of government have different authorities. And in fact, it could put federal up here because they would have the authority over licensing.
As well as food inspection agencies as well.
Right, are they
federal?
Yes.
CRD.
And then, you know, the other one that I noticed is First Nations. I got that in the list. Where we put that?
Press at the top.
Flesh out and get a better understanding. And then, you know, for the geographic areas, we need to kind of come to terms with that too, even though we have our three broad geographies defined. And how would you go about framing recommendations that won't necessarily, for example, affect big areas of geography, right? So a lot of people, for example, probably, what would it be safe to say, you know, do nothing? I'm just putting a question out there. In Oak Bay, it might be a different situation because that seems to be where a lot of the complaints are generated. You know, even relative to Missoula, for example, where we don't think we had some, but not, you know, relative, not the same volume as we had from Oak Bay. And the agricultural areas, which is the best level of jurisdiction to consider your recommendations?
Well, it just depends on the way I look at it. It depends on what conclusion is, you know, I'm assuming, and just from my own thoughts, that there's going to be a multi-pronged approach to this, whatever strategy is suggested. And again, depending on what is picked as the main or two or three main options, that will determine which of those governmental agencies is the lead, so to speak. Definitely the province is going to take a lead in a lot of it based on their ownership, per se, of the deer. You know, you need the permits to move them, you need permits to hunt them, you need permits, you know, so definitely they're a major player in this. You know, municipalities, in a sense, because they have the bylaws that restrict, you know, whether it be if there's a cull going to happen, and or if there's fencing or a spraying of all of this, you know, those bylaws have to be dealt with. So again, I think it depends on what are the main options that are going to be put forward.
Maybe we could go through each option and list the different jurisdictions that would be involved in each strategy. Or that makes sense.
Yeah, we could do that. We could create another little table here that So phasing and fracking.
Federal jurisdiction.
That's federal jurisdiction, but the federal, they regulate whether it's used in certain provinces or not?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's all federal, yeah.
All federal?
So just one more point, just moving on to easing, and I just realized that probably in Wanapico electoral area and in Salt Spring and in Southern Del Islands, any kind of noise would be CRD. Those are noise bylaws that come under CRD.
So JDF?
Yeah.
Electoral. Okay, so back to repellents, then do I remove the province? Am I hearing that it's all federally registered?
Our role would be repellents, the repellents, yes. I don't know if they're really, provincially regulated. I think our comment from our food safety person was that use repellents according to the label.
According to the label.
According to the label, which I mean, I think that would be kind of.
Okay. It's a new warrior.
Facilitate fencing?
Is the answer yes or no?
Well, you can always lobby government to set up a program. quite a fencing program going on in the interior, mostly the interior province, to protect safety for a long road. So there's a fairly large fencing program going on in the interior to fence most primary and secondary highways. But that's to keep livestock from wandering onto those highways. And that's coming through the Ministry of Transportation. So there are, when issues come to a point, and I get a kick out of what Central Center is at, and go through this as lobbying groups, whatever the lobbying group. And so I think there's always a route to lobby, say, for a fencing program.
Well, that would be the district of Central Center, but they just by the payment of the district.
Yeah, some other municipalities have no fencing and height restrictions at all, or they don't like that.
Right, but if I heard you correctly, you said that if land in the AR, that would apply in Central Center.
For Central Center, it's an issue, but say for North Center, it's not an issue. They don't have a fencing height restriction on farmland.
Right, but, okay, so maybe I misheard. That if the land is in the ALR, then there isn't a claim to under the right to farm legislation. The municipality has the ability to set the regulation.
Yeah, but it's kind of a gray area, so it hasn't been challenged. Let's leave it like.
Well, you have a question right there, so.
Okay, all right. So yeah, that conversation actually brought up a couple things. So these are regulatory functions, but there may also be a role, like regulatory role, but there may also be an incentive funding role that we should pick up on the ways we hear too. So we need to regulatory and
I
So this has to be like public. Yeah, exactly.
The word, does make sense for open copy and region collect. And actually, it's trust, it's a new development. I'm trusted the land is on the long island.
So explain that to me.
Well, one of the things we're talking about is landscape, retrofitting your yard to avoid deer.
Correct. Yep.
But if it's a new development, a long range subdivision, putting in place landscaping is too discouraging or completely.
Well, yeah, we still get into the fact that those are private properties and.
If the development permits all over the lot, the city, there's a foundation. Particularly in the CRD, lots of popular colleagues in that side of it, there's land use rules in the CRD are probably the numbers.
I don't think it would be given the land use, but I think our stormwater department might have some nice practices or something that gets included in the, I don't think it's developed in permit areas, but it might be designed guidelines within it.
In order to receive development permit in the CRD outside of municipal areas, typically you are required to have a report from a qualified professional to address a whole range of things, including water use, runoff, soils, and use of native plants, and so you have a common strategy to be able to.
So they implement those through the covenant?
They implement through the development permit, condition on development permit. Install the wastewater treatment, groundwater, not treatment, but groundwater, flood control, and water is with a report from who's that public engineer.
Right, but that's the developer. And then all the land gets conveyed to the private owner.
Well, but it goes.
Runs with the land, runs with the title.
Well, yeah, otherwise if it's meaningless, it doesn't mean requiring the developer and installing.
But I mean, in practical terms, enforcement then must be.
Oh, enforcement is through the building inspector.
Right.
You need the building permit, the building permit, if you need to be.
Yeah, I didn't realize that, but I guess it's in practical terms, people are going to expect to be planning, so it's probably. Well, you could, this could happen.
Depends where you are.
And it could have a municipality that has a bylaw or policy that any development requires landscaping.
One of my neighbors and friend, they had property in San Diego, highway, 4 years to build the subdivision process, and as part of that, they required a wide range of things. The one of my team had a sandwich. So it's not that uncommon for you to develop. Because just as easily said, don't find anything in the drive theater. That could have been uncommon, but you can do that as well.
Okay, municipal is.
And I think you have to include the region in the region has land use supported. And I think you have to include the prosecutors in the Bay of Land use supported.
I missed that last one half.
That's kind of interesting. I was trust.
Oh, yeah.
And we have to include provincially other things too from the invasive species point of view.
Yeah. What was that?
We might have to include that in that sort of problems just from the invasive species.
There must be, so we would pass it.
Adams Trust.
Adams, well, it's not maybe Adams Trust.
That could be a problem, too, just this is too different logging by, you know, the town.
I mean, there's certainly no shooting and dominating areas of provincial regulation. Dominating the one if you go to Doral area, I think actually with the Salt Spring or something like that, Doral area, or just the one in Dallas.
It would be interesting to find out, I guess.
There is.
Well, we did have, someone look at the CRD bylaws for number of reasons.
If you look in your package, there is a review of all.
Somebody has to restrict discharge of firearms on the lines. Maybe it's one on.
Yeah, there's certain sections of the BC regs that have.
That's what we do, that's fine.
Okay, so there's a question that control of firearms for non-municipal areas, so the electoral areas. So it's pretty similar to the one. Whether or not that's provincial or something else. So, a good question. Sharpshooting, what you're saying, pretty much?
Actually, under those last two, federal as well, because to, well, sharpshooting for sure, but depending on what the public hunting is using, you need a firearms license to discharge a firearm, or to even own a firearm. So federal as well, when it comes to firearms ownership and use.
There's also the use of a need to, is that you federal? No, you federal.
Well, there is also the Center of Disease Control.
Right.
So it could be a provincial, that's a provincial role. So for setting meat regulations for consumption of meat within the province, that's the Center of Disease Control in the province. So that it could be a player. I'm not saying absolutely. Well, it's just that someone has to inspect the meat, and if it is staying, there's two sets of regulations. There's the federal regulation and provincial regulation for meat. So
would it be safe to say then for these two, that both firearms and meat, both federal and provincial?
Yeah, I guess. Yeah. And we can define that as most more than likely. It's going to stay within the province in some form, right? Yeah. So I think that would be provincial.
Okay.
Yeah, I think kind of about that for a truck.
Also, if it's a First Nations country, then a lot of that doesn't apply. And they just go directly to the community of the hunter and they process it as an individual. Mm-hmm. Or in my community's case, we do it as a community.
So could we say that this one, the tree drapes here?
Sure.
Well, then this is a region, I mean, it's a power.
whoever decides where they're going to go, it's going to go through probably.
I don't know that we're going to incorporate the area that one, it would be, based on everything, based on that statement that we had today, that there are, I don't think there are any incorporated areas. So I think the province would have to look at that. They wouldn't put them, they wouldn't put them in the county, no, you know, there's very.
Cards and everything.
Same.
Would.
For the, both the capturing, wouldn't municipalities be involved? Like, can you just show up with nets in the middle of the boulevard somewhere in the city? They would think the municipality would have to be involved in some way.
Whether there's a form, whether there's.
I don't know if it would, like, obviously the municipality being involved jurisdictionally, but if it would more be the tribal landowner that would, like, you know, like, the municipality would give you authority, but you would still, wait, there's not much public land in a lot of municipalities you could use to do that. So I think it would be more the individual landowner to provide permission.
I think trying to do any kind of wild animal protection within the municipal boundary without the municipality on the side and authorizing it self-action, who's going to do it? The CRD is a bit of a limit. Set it by your staff and start sending crabs to obey. As obey says, please come in.
Well, we said, we have no service that covers.
Nobody does, but I meant, my point is, even if you had the money, security, you wouldn't, neither would the province, you wouldn't go in and do it for municipal objections. So whether you call it jurisdiction or whether it's de facto law, they have to agree. It should not always just happen.
The municipality.
Oh, yeah, the municipality will find all sorts of ways to, if they don't want it to happen, to get away. Not to mention that the CRD board is made up of municipal directors and they're not going to. So I think.
And the leasing is under municipal as well.
Yeah, I think practically speaking, you know, every time Victoria wants to stop it, they just stop the lease every time you see a captured lease vehicle, you want to give it a ticket and tow it.
Okay, but.
They will go.
In order to share this, what permission is permitted? Not with the.
It's for the most part, we tell the province what we want, if that's what we want to do, and the province takes over from there. So that's presumably they take care. You know, presumably they would go and do their own things with municipalities. For the most part, the region.
Is that a huge mistake to set this strategy out talking about capture and lease and capture and use and not acknowledging municipal authority?
I
don't think we would.
And we need to evolve this into a discussion about partnerships.
No, I don't think it's a partnership. I think you have to accept the fact that municipalities have the ability to control that direct activity. But whether it's strictly legal or whether it's a combination of legal and political, because neither the CRD nor the provincial government are going to send the wildland branch in, so you have a wildland branch of staff. But they're not going to send them in with the traps and start taking care of them, okay, unless the council comes out with it and invites them in. And all we do by ignoring that is ignoring a bunch of people.
Okay, so that's, can we take a run through?
I just want to ask this question, and it's no answer really, but what about when the conservation service is going to areas to catch a cougar or anything else? Do they receive permission to go and do that?
In a technical sense, probably not, but if you use the deer in Victoria's latest example, they were invited in by the Victoria police.
Right.
Because the Victoria police didn't want to pick up the elephant shield. Could the police have done it themselves? I suspect they haven't. I'm not sure if they suspect they
could.
Thinking of that too, would the SPC be involved?
This provincial law still.
Okay, can I get you to hold that? I want to get through this once. province holds the, you know, authority for that. But who should, where's the decision best about using that? Because
well, that's where it seems like it's the municipality.
Yes,
there are the society of the men.
Right, right. Because the geography comes into play, right? Because the location of the issue comes into play. And so we can say that it's not necessarily CRD wide, right? So where's the issue?
I don't want to believe it, but I think it is a regulatory issue.
Same with this one, capturing noise, same combination, or
same plus the what did kind of it's a combination of everything from sharpshooting and from capturing the locate.
Because there's mean involved?
Yeah. And firearms.
Or I guess.
About using a penetrating bullet gun or a firearm. It also talks about using tranquilizers. If you use tranquilizers, can you use the meat still? You can.
And then I don't think we have any limitations on the location, right?
So I guess that's going to be,
back to because whoever's going to be responsible for the cost for this is also going to be, should be on that list as well, because it would have to be approved for whatever governing body.
Well, let's just put that aside for now, okay? Because what we're trying to get at, what I'm trying to get at here, is to see, we're talking about all of the potential partners that might be involved in administering whatever package of options is recommended, right? Just to get a clearer sense of who actually has to be involved from a permission standpoint. And then also, the other element is that we have these three kind of macro geographies, but from a common sense perspective, from an on-the-ground perspective of where the how the issues are perceived and where they're perceived, what jurisdictions would make the most sense for taking the recommendations that you do make and putting them into action. For other stakeholders, for a lot of these, would we also say private landowners? That's one of them. That's one of the stakeholders. In general? In general, yeah, I think that's kind of fair to say on all of them. And then I'm also thinking there's other major landowners like Uvic, or a lot of there are, or I don't know, the airport ones, like any places where we've got major deer populations. Great. So we put here.
No, sorry, not the European.
I these are public decisions. So we should, how do we tackle that?
Well, I think that they are individual actions. They're actions taken by individual homeowners.
The rest of these. Yeah, not the ones that are the purple. The purple ones are.
Government action.
But could we say, it's not just government, but your vehicle is municipal?
Yeah.
Well, that's government.
Yeah, no, but we're gentlemen, I mean, we get more specific. We could say that your vehicle, like even the star under municipal, that's where the action is with the your vehicle or with the control of the hunting.
Oh, and sure, you want me to identify.
I'm just thinking that's the the actor in each of those.
Yeah, that's a fencing problem.
Yeah, so just note me the note under easy fighting.
So where am I putting the sharpshooter? Province?
Yeah.
Possible like this, but those are the following region this way.
You think they're gonna fall into that? Education.
Where would the decision best be made? I don't know.
Well, if it's per, I don't know how the, how they do their approvals, but it seems to me that they would probably be running some kind of pilot project.
They're going to, it's a long-term thing, it's determined that there's not going to be any effects over time.
Yeah. So I said we set this asterisk to purple. These are the ones that are needed to implement. But what about First Nations? They aren't necessarily required to implement, but they could be helpful in some cases.
Oh, yeah, for some of them. Assisting action, recording, capturing, organizing, maybe, but you know, the any of the issues,
right?
They aren't issues within any of the reserves that I know of.
So they could be an assist on this one.
Probably.
And anything else?
Well, in terms of those two, you know, the construction, when you may find individuals within the communities there just as well as you can find them out in the general public, in the general hunting population, hunters population. So I would guess, well, for sure they have to be the same if they're using a farmer along with them of some sort, they still have to be regulated by the feds. They need that for our assessment.
Yeah.
And they probably won't have to deal with the problems in terms of taking the animal out of season. Yes. And again, depending on the requirement of the province in granting permits to individuals or just to the project in itself. Those issues, they may not come into play in terms of seasons or gender-based taking the animals.
One of the recommendations that came up all over the feedback was to give the deer to the First Nation. So if that's, so you had brought up in the beginning,
The capacity.
I don't know if this is a good time to speak to that, but I'm just thinking of on the end of, you know, if whether it's First Nations or not First Nations doing the hunting, what about the end of the capacity?
Well, I'll give you an example, and I shared this with Jeff and Mark when I was chatting with them previously. And as I mentioned, my job. Part of my job in my community is to create projects, programs for healthier and better lifestyles. Mm-hmm. One of the projects that we've been doing for about 3 or 4 years now is training hunters in our community, because it has become less and less for a lot of reasons. But we start basically, it's from field to freezer, and you know everything that goes along with it. The hunting is just a means to an end. You know, it teaches ethics, environmental awareness, providing young men, young women with a means to provide nutritious organic food, you know, to increase the health of their family. Well, we organize community hunts out in the field, out in the islands, out in the greater and island area. And we taught young folks in our community farm safety, help them get their farm's license, traditional teachings around hunting. And we had 4 or 5 workshops per se, again, field to freezer. Skinning and quartering, proper butchering techniques, wrapping, freezing, cooking techniques and, you know, again, recipes and again, the whole process. And we've done, like I say, a number of these, and it went from very few people in my community to 18 to 20 households that would participate. So when we were working with Parks Canada and the Salas Group, the island owners, the property owners on Sydney Island, we received beer from them regularly when they do their calls, their yearly calls. And as long as we have advance notice to get the communities, the families in the community back for these workshops. And it's got to the point now where instead of hosting workshops per se, where the community comes into to the kitchens where we've prepared, we can bring quartered up beer right to the homes and they just process it at homes. Now, I'm not sure if any of the other communities in Saanich, other than my own, or in Greater Victoria, Tune Victoria, do that. As an organized activity, I know there are families that do that, where they will, individual families will go up and have a hunt and bring it to one home where they will go and do that on a very small scale. But as an organized community, I think we're the ones that can do that. So we can do it. We do have the capacity and the knowledge now to do it, but it was a process to get it done to this point.
And then we're also talking about numbers too, right? We don't know yet how many deer we're talking about, but it's 20,700 deer that is in a year.
I'll use myself as an example. One year I went out hunting and I killed 17 deer in one year. But again, I provided for my family, my extended family, and individuals in my community. It isn't just all from my freezer.
Right.
Some years I'll own five.
Right.
And, you know, but, you know, my family will go through a deer. If that's just all we're having, we'll do one a month. So, the capacity, it can fluctuate. Yeah, you know, like I say, we've had upwards of 10, 12 deer at one time. So there is enough capacity within my community to carry on for a while anyway.
So, but if, we don't know the numbers, but, it's in the other there, talking about numbers like 500 deer in a year. That's even more in a much bigger area.
Yes. Well, actually, Sydney Island is quite small.
Yeah, because I mean, it's a word, yeah. Quite a much bigger range, so I don't know if the numbers are going to be much bigger than that.
Well, the thing with Sydney Island, they did it in a very short period of time when they did their hunts. This, I would, if there was going to be a call, I don't think it would be compact in such a short period of time. It would be over a long period of time. Plus, it would, if it's going to be done, in my opinion, it needs to be sustained, you know, year after year. Initially, the numbers might be large, but if it's a sustained type of a call, then it would be smaller numbers, but, you know, throughout the years.
Okay, so,
Okay.
Any thing we're missing here? That needs to be, that I think you need to think about a little
you frame the recommendations of getting from these three kind of macro level geographies to more specific areas that weren't, not that you need to identify that, but maybe that's how you frame the recommendations, is acknowledging that you're not necessarily making recommendation that's expected to be carried out carte blanche across all urban areas or across all rural areas. So, the other thing that we wanted to cover off and a little bit of time is this whole question of format and content. I'm paraphrasing that. So, from the actual term of reference, it says, agreeing on the format and content of the management strategy. You have a table of contents, right, that we're working from that you're starting to pull together the first few sections for the group's consideration. And then last week, we talked about the beginning of a conversation on the framework for your recommendations. So we acknowledge that we have these three geographies. We acknowledge that the year vehicle collision is across all geographies, it wasn't really specific to one. There was a discussion about short and long term and context, particularly of agriculture. And then now we also then talked about outcome statements. So we were trying to, sort of having a discussion around them. Possibility of an outcome statement. What is it we're trying to achieve? And then use the technique of backcasting, these arrays, to say, all right, so if this is our goal, then how do we get there? What's the bundle that gets us there? So, notice anything from last week? This is, not even a very high level summary, but that's essentially where we got to. And then started talking about, again, specific to agriculture, the short term February 2013, and what is long term, and so on. So that was just part of the general conversation, which is all good. So tonight, before we get back into the specifics like that, I thought that it would be a good idea to talk about how we're going to get to recommendations. What process, and either just really straw dough, what process do you want to use to try to get from where we are now with this information, your binary information, all the minutes, notes, this little discussion that we had on roles and authorities and who would be required to be involved in implementing whatever strategy you come up with. So now thinking about some background process, how we get from all of that to here. So do we want to task you with coming up with individual recommendations? Do you want to form subcommittees so that you work on a specific component like agriculture, for example, or urban, for example? Do you want to do it by group think, which everybody involved in kind of, muscling through and coming up with the wording of recommendations. Are there other suggestions from the group? So that's one question. And the second is to agree on how you're going to make the decisions. Right now you have two options in your terms of reference. Consensus and vote. And then what we try to do all along is record the majority of these particular, in either of these cases, consensus or voting, you're always going to have some folks that are, alternate-minded or contrary-minded to the consensus or to the vote. So we thought that it was important to think this through and try to most of the strategy. We basically got two more meetings. for next week, and then we'll kind of play it by ear. We're thinking that we would then take a break for a week to let Jeff write, and then come back for two meetings, and that's the wrap up to get to a committee report for August. So, with that in mind, then it's hard to kind of monkey any back of time all the time. But what method do you want to use to get from where we are now, considerations fully discussed, and contemplating bundling options? So would it be a good thing though to, you just said it, go away and think about all of this and feel free to put pen to paper or whatever works best for you and come with a few straw models that we can put up and start talking about?
Sure.
Does that work, Lisa?
Yeah, I think things seem to be more faster once we have stuff to look at and we can already kind of weigh in, and then we could look through and critique the patterns that were emerging. I think that would speed things up a bit and still give people a chance to contribute without getting the paper damaged.
Okay, that's excellent.
I wasn't clear on the schedule. Is there two more meetings than three?
No.
Might be a bit off topic, but when I first introduced myself, I had said that I didn't have a lot of time to be a part of this, and I coming in at the end, when I spoke with Jeff and Mark, I told them that I didn't have a lot of time, but again, I've been following the process and, you know, aware of, you know, the different things that have gone on, so I've kind of come to some conclusions, some ideas, recommendations, and comments about, you know, what I've read and what I've heard and what I've seen so far. But before I get to that, you know, I'm going to use a couple of analogies in terms of what I see this problem and what I, how I see this issue. Growing up as a child, I lived in Seattle, and my family lived in the rural housing area. And they were basically long cylindrical boxes, and they were divided up into apartments, and you know, that's basically what it was. And one of the issues, there was always a rodent or cockroach infestations in our houses growing up, and I can recall all of the time. And every now and then, the project managers, I guess you could say, they would come in and they would do spraying to rid the places of the cockroach infestations. And they would always start at one end, and you would one day it would be this family, the next day this. We always felt sorry for the house on the end, because as they start exterminating, the cockroaches just moved from house to house, and they ran all the way to the end. But as all you know, and that's not the important piece, but the important piece was in the education of how to keep them from coming back. And there was always a multitude of things to get done to deal with the issue. And that's the way I see this problem. It isn't only one. You know, we've heard from many different individuals in the CRD region about if this should be done or that should be done. And, you know, this group wants that and that group wants this. And it isn't going to be an easy answer. And I give you good folks kudos for, you know, being strong, for, you know, being a part of this process. I see, you know, I heard that there are some things that can be done. The education, I think, is the most critical, because, you know, whatever, the more people know about the issue and how to deal with it, the easier it is to deal with the problem. So education is critical. You know, understanding what you folks have learned in the last 2 months about deer, how they live, how they react to people. So that is, I think, critical. The other analogy I want to use, and you folks that have out buildings, and you know, the folks that have the farms are quite aware of this. You know, mice and rat infestations are unbelievable, the damage they can do, and I liken deer to that. You know, we have a saying in my community about the deer, and deer are like rabbits. They will multiply. They're like the rodents. They will multiply unchecked. They will eat everything, they will cause damage, they will be bothersome. And, you know, Ken, in his presentation, I've known Ken for a while. He used to be a part of meetings I attended, various points on the island. And I've seen his presentation. He's a very knowledgeable man, and I respect his knowledge. And in his presentation, he mentioned, and I know he presented that to you folks as well, that you cannot get an accurate deer count, whether you're in the wild or whether you're in the city. It's just not possible for a lot of reasons. You know, when you think you know the deer, they change. They you can hunt them, but then they become nocturnal. They're, you know, deer have amazing eyesight, and they know those are just, you know, they rival dogs. So they know when you're there, and they change, you know, they're built on survival. That's what they try to do. So they will change, and you'll never get an accurate count, no matter how you do it or where you do it. But, like rabbits and like mice and like rats, it's just a matter of time where they will reach the carrying capacity of whatever their environment will allow them to. And people can argue this fact, but they will, I won't use the term overrun, but they will increase their population in this area until it becomes worse. You know, we think it's bad now. In 5 years, if nothing is done, whatever is done, it will reach that point. Personally, I favor culling for a lot of reasons. You've heard a few of my reasons earlier in regards to the capacity to use the venison for nutrition based ideas. And it doesn't have to be just the First Nations community. You know, it can be, I know in the interior they use the food banks as a depository for the venison that's captured and euthanized. So that's an option as well. The relocation I learned today, just as you folks did, relocation is a difficult process, not very successful, but in the end result is you minimized your deer population. It may not be popular, but it does work. Sterilization, you know, I don't think it should be an option, to be honest with you. It's costly, it's iffy, it's not, you know, and Jeff mentioned as well, it's not even, you know, the feds wouldn't even think of it. You know, there's nothing that I think in place to do that. But short-term gains, you know, long-term benefits, or short-term pains, I should say, long-term gains and benefits. It's, you know, there's other options for sure, but education, I think, is the key. You know, everyone needs to be on side, regardless of their stripe that they wear in terms of what they feel about this problem. It will get worse. You know, you guys can argue and debate all you want, and our community, the public, can argue and debate about the issue, but it will get worse. And my last comment, you know, looking up at that docs that Mark was just making, and, you know, there's a reason why there aren't any deer problems in the First Nations communities.
I'm looking for that. confirmed in the degree which it captured what you perceived in the process, cabinets, opinions, right, that, all those types of things.
I just mean, when I'm editing, I'm not going to stop, but I'm arranging the problem.
Yeah, you can say, you know, I've got the table of contents that we worked with a little bit, and I kind of worked with that as best I could, but, you know, it's not set in stone. Feel free to, if it makes more sense, you can definitely recommend shifting things around as they make sense to any of you. The online feedback, Corey, did you bring this week?
I did bring this week.
Okay, so we've got the online feedback coming from you this week. There's the three options, the three management options that we have out there. So there's some of the feedback. There weren't that many, but I think we're running into the exhaustion side of things. We hit people with a barrage for 5 or 6 weeks in a row, and we're getting decreasing numbers. So do with it as you will. The long form, the open-ended questions will be available once we've got a chance to categorize them. Earlier, when the meeting first started, Lisa put together a piece at some effort regarding environmental monitoring and indicators. So if you haven't got her two-pager there that she put together, just see me and I'll make sure you get one on the way out. But thank you, Lisa, for putting that together for everyone. And at the end, in the correspondence, I sent out an email on Thursday or Friday. One of the things, we got some answers back on the Blankensop question as to whether or not there were any impacts of signage and speed limitations or any efforts that signage can put in to reduce the number of lanes on Blankensop Road. And the effective answer was there was no improvement. In fact, we had seen it gotten worse over time. And they've been longer there since 1997. So I didn't know if anyone had wanted to pass comment on that. I did get it in the first correspondence section, so I wanted to give if anybody had any thoughts, provide an opportunity for those of you. Failing that, that's it for my remarks and next steps in outstanding items. Unless anyone has said outstanding items. Yeah, and I put that out to the ERWG, and I haven't heard back. I got answers back on the other answers, but I suspect it's a very difficult answer, very question to answer.
I will go through it and put it out again to the period, and then you'll leave the answers out.
And
just found this for City Island. It just says one employee or Parks Canada staff member moves quietly over here and dispatches 46 animals with a bullpen. So it's the province. Or Parks Canada.
So that's, that was taught. Park these with parks. And it arranges with the south school to call. But it is with the shop shoot. They actually shoot.
So they're saying it's the staff member that makes the shop shoot, is it? That's what they say here.
I can't recall who actually told the truth, but it is possible. Awesome. Actually, you're right. It is Parks Town staff. Because I remember when we were going up to the pen. There was a couple of fellows there that they were park staff. Mm-hmm.
Was that just on the park side, or was that something called?
Both, actually, depending on the time. The one that we were doing was on the park side, but the Salas group were park landowners.
Like they hired that.
Oh, it was unbelievable. You know, I'll give you the numbers, and maybe you may have heard them already, but in a 3-year period, they called about 2,000 deer off that island. And yes, they did bring in, I'm sorry, I didn't know the name, somebody that does the processing and skinning them and bringing the food inspection folks and performing the process. So, yeah, it's quite large numbers over the years. And they actually sell the venison. To butchers or whomever, and that is what pays for the cost of the people to come out.
Part of it was 30 years ago that they might have not seen that. It's all the provincial part of that. And the structure that we use is actually a collector from the provincial museum.
Interesting.
Or just said there's some extra copies of some of the
each of the 11 management options and evaluation worksheets as outdated as the previous meetings. Obviously, the changes that we made are not electronic worksheets.
But everything, all the changes from last week.
Yes.
And updated here. So,
yes.
So if you want to go away and use with updated copies of the evaluation criteria sheets, it would be so better.
And we also have, again, as of the beginning of this meeting, I apologize, I don't have rural, I have urban agriculture and clean mitigation. And as I will not be here next week, I will see you next week.
I'm sorry, you're okay.
Corey, if you could just touch base with me, I'm sure you're going to be able to avoid the
forces. Yes, yes. Not all work. Yes.